Yeah, man, nice to meet you,
Patrick. Pleasure.
Man, pleasure's all my brother.
How are you?
I know you guys are running like crazy.
Yeah, we have the flight at 4 p.m.
Don't wait, you guys work. I would have met you, but I couldn't pick up my son.
And then we were supposed to drive, he was supposed to pick us up at 11, but there was some traffic that came by at 12.
New York shit happened. It's just a little minute. I'm great.
Cool.
So how's it going?
We good.
Oh, good. And still excited about New York, you know. Even though we're leaving, we're like, you know, it's cool.
You guys are here tonight. There's a good show tonight. J. Period has Rakim and Carl Munch.
I'm coming. I'm
out. Tomorrow is Kane's
birthday. Yeah, tomorrow's Kane's birthday.
What is that? SOB's or somewhere else?
Kane's birthday or tonight?
Tonight.
Tonight is at Sony Hall.
Nice.
We were there last week and we're at Y Club
performing. Yeah, Y Club, yeah.
J. Period presents. Pharoah Munch, Black Thought, and Rakim.
Wow.
And he hit me to come out as a guest.
That's dope.
So it's pretty cool. Yes, I look forward.
Okay, so we're rebooking our flights.
We should. Black sheep in your house, party people you
remember, the two that serve your whole crew like the boards. I don't know if you guys have heard, I just released a project called Torch Your Soul.
Yes, sir.
So I just
let's talk about it. Let's go to the benches maybe and then let's talk about it.
So that's what's up, man. So that's cool. Y'all had a good trip.
Yeah, definitely.
Man, we've been doing every day something else. Like
Like every time we speak, you know, we got to do this, but I'm gonna try to get you over here.
Yeah.
You know, we're doing this, but you know,
like our schedule was full, but I'm glad that we got a chance to meet up.
And sometimes, you know, like I knew we had spoke before y'all came, so I already knew we were gonna we were gonna get together, even if it was for a second.
Right.
But both of us were moving.
Yeah. True.
So good.
Except for Staten Island, because we didn't go
there. Queens and Staten Island, very different.
But we stayed in Brooklyn, we went to the Bronx,
Manhattan,
to Harlem, to Guanajuato.
When my first record came out, I lived in the Bronx, because that was the only place that I could afford. On my own, you know, I found a cheap, real cheap apartment, 2-bedroom apartment on 183rd and Valentine, which is not the nicest environment you want to be in. But when you're 19, 20 years old, when I was 20, 21, you don't care, you know what I'm saying? So when our record came out, everyone thought we were from the Bronx because that's where I live, but I was from Queens, you know?
So you're kind of undercover there.
Yeah. But it afforded me, it got me an opportunity to get real tight with some really good Bronx cats.
Right.
Me and Showbiz used to share a house together.
Mm-hmm.
That's like a brother to me. That's like my favorite person in the entire industry.
Nice.
And you know, if it wasn't for me having lived in the Bronx, we wouldn't have had that relationship.
Gotcha.
You know? So it was cool. It was cool. Then, but you know, but I always, you know, had to let cats know, like, yo, I'm from Queens. But I love the Bronx.
This is Dres, Dres, Mister. You can get with this, Black Sheep.
Running C,
Tribe. But now there's some good ones. There's some big cats. You know, you get definitely the LL. You know what I'm saying?
Yes,
get the mob. Definitely. You know what I'm saying? You know, but at the same time, you know, like, there's cats from, you know, Large Professor to Neek to, I mean, you know, like, there's cats Flush. Like, there's the underground cats that are really, like, that are really, take your head off. A lot of Queens cats. On the low. A lot of Queens cats get busy.
Rocking it is why you know me by myself, but never lonely, homie. Horses couldn't hold me. With the blicky, Shinobi, locking it on every level. Hello, my mellow, you jello metal for having no metal. Masterpieces see me revel, so sheen, dope fiend. Dreams conceived in Queens. Burrow, thorough, my flow, nitro, glycerine.
We are sending in the Queens with a dress from Black Sheep.
No doubt. I'm glad to be here, man. Big salute to everybody checking us out today. I know you guys been busy, so I appreciate y'all taking a moment. Kick it with your dude.
Yeah, we have a flight back in 3 hours from JFK. So this is our last day.
We're squeezing it a little bit.
Last chance to meet up. And could you tell us exactly where we are?
Right now we're in the hood known as Forest Hills. It's a really cool part of Queens that you know, this is like the opposite of Queensbridge. Mm-hmm. Okay. It's like nothing's gonna happen. Everything's kind of cool, you know. And this is where I live for years and years. I'm a Queens cat. I've been in Queens most of my life, and I've been fortunate to live in pretty much every borough in New York, but always Queens at heart. So I'm, you know, just kind of in my hood, just chopping it up and kicking it, you know, the New York way here.
And you just released a project, Torture. So could you tell us something more about the concept, the title, which is also very interesting, like the songs that you decided to put there?
Tortured Soul, it's really dope project. I'm really, really glad to bring to the people. It represents a few years of work. Like what I did was kind of put together like different pieces of work I've done independently over the last few years and merged them with some new stuff. And the way that that it's done, I sat with a good friend of mine by the name of evitaN from Seattle, a dope producer. And we had done a mixtape some years ago, and the way that we did it, everything kind of merged into itself. You know what I'm saying? Like it was just different sequencing and cutting things short and extending things and adding little musical nuances to introduce the next piece. And we kind of pieced it together like that. And the title, Tortured Soul, it's kind of duality to it. Whereas, you know, it's like these days everybody's like just trying to get along but not getting along, and you know, like everybody feels like, you know, like they're owed something but nobody's willing to work for anything that they want, you know. And we're in this instant gratification place of short memory spans, and instead of albums, playlists, right. And you know, it's not even about what's good for the soul, you know what I'm saying? It's just about almost just existing to a degree. And it's torture to someone like me, I'm sure to a lot of other people, whereas, you know, like you want something you could feel and you want something you can love and embrace and something that's reflective of yourself and something you can be proud of. And that's not just for a short attention span, but that'll be here the next generation and the generation after that, you know? And so, you know, Tortured Soul to me is just a reflection of that kind of energy being put into an album, saying that, you know, like I'm gonna give y'all a piece of what I feel, of who I am as an entity. And it's not to say that I have, you know, that I'm a tortured entity, but just to say that, you know what I'm saying, that I feel like we're not giving the best of ourselves, even in our music, you know what I'm saying? And it's become this real cookie cutter. When I was young, you got accolades and you got props for sounding like no one. But today, you get props and accolades for sounding just like someone.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And, you know, it just makes me feel like, you know, like it's just all regurgitation to a degree. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, how many times can we remix the remix of the remix? Right. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, I'm at a point where I'm like, you know, like it's cool to be authentic. Even if you fall flat on your face, even if you don't make it, just be yourself. And that's good enough to make it if you just believe. Like, we got caught up in the blueprint of someone else. It's not your blueprint, you know what I'm saying? Like, have the heart to make your own blueprint and make your own failures and your own successes and live your own life by learning it not vicariously through technology, you know what I'm saying? But by living it through living and breathing and touching and smelling and feeling and sharing, you know?
Right, and when you first came on the scene as Black Sheep, you brought a unique vibe and sense of humor that was kind of like unheard of before. Like, even when you started the album with the intro and the first song, that was kind of like mocking gangster rap. So what inspired, like, you know, the whole vibe that you created then, and the sense of humor and the message that you were putting in the tracks?
I was really, really blessed to be a member of the native tongue, not to even to be as in presently, like, and so I got the chance to sit around with the Tribe Called Quest, sit around with Jungle Brothers, sit around with De La Soul, Moni Love, Queen Latifah, and even see how they addressed the industry, recording, just their walk. And I was fortunate enough to take from all of them that it's cool to just be myself. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And if something's funny to me, it might be funny to you too. And I kid you not, when we was making our records for the first album, we were making them more for the groups than for the public, because we felt like if we could impress the group, the public, we wouldn't have a problem with the public. So we were trying to impress the natives, you know, and like I said, like, they're really sharp guys, especially musically, like very, very sharp. So we had to literally, like, in my opinion, like, push ourselves to be witty, push ourselves to be sharp or to say something in a way that would make someone say, oh, wow, you know what I'm saying? And that we were able to kind of win them over, the people were just right behind them, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? So, you know, like, I learned early that it's to your advantage to give of yourself to your project. You don't have to have this facade in your head of who you should be or how you should be. Just be, you know what mm-hmm. I'm saying? And if something is funny to you, express it. If something is hurtful to you, express it. I mean, whatever it is, it's okay, and you don't have to be afraid of it existing within your music or within yourself, you know what I'm saying? Like, one thing I've learned, you know what I'm saying? Like, I don't care what color you are. I don't care what gender. I don't care what religion. There's good and bad people of every single sect, color, race, religion, gender, you know what I'm saying? Period. So you find in life those that are like you, you know what I'm saying? And you try to stay away from things that are to your detriment. Mm-hmm. And that goes across the board. That goes across the board. You'll find good men and women of every color. And you'll find bad men and women of every color. You know what I'm saying? So don't get so caught up in the semantics of what you see as much as what you experience, mm-hmm. as much as what you know, as much as, you know, as much as who you are, you give is as much as you receive, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, we really kind of floating real quickly all around mm-hmm. the globe with it. But just to say, I bring it all back to say that, you know what I'm saying? Be authentic and accept authentic vibes, you know what I'm saying? When no one's perfect, we're all gonna make mistakes, we can all learn from each other. And this is a time in the world when what I'm saying, like, probably needs to be really adhered to. Like, we all need each other in order for this world to work correctly. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? I don't care what country you live in. We all play off of each other. And if one of us falls down and we don't bend down to help them up, then we're even lower than the person that fell. You know right. what I'm saying? Like, we all got to make it our business to be better people, to be stronger, to be wiser, to make this world what it's supposed to be. And in the midst of the world being what it's supposed to be is dope hip hop. You know what I'm saying? Period.
Right, and I was always wondering, like, in the beginnings of Native Dawg's movement, like, how close were you guys? Like, were you, like, hanging out on the regular, like, every single day? Or was it more like a loose collective? Just, you know, everybody, like, being in different parts of the city and just collabing on music?
Nah, this is a time when there was no sending each other tracks. Right. You know what I'm saying? We were together almost every single day. And it was so dope to me. That's why a lot of those records sound how they sound, mm-hmm. because it was just something that was amongst all of us. It didn't matter whose session it was, we'd all come to the studio. Mm-hmm. We'd find out whose session it was when we got there. Sometimes we'd wake up with each other at the studio like, wow, like, we turn over and you're literally like, you know, fucking Phife's foot is on your, or, you know, like, you're laying on Pasta Noose's arm, you know, like, you're like, yo, what's going on? Like, you know, from the session from that night, like, we all were together and we were all so selfless and just young and having fun. Mm-hmm. And we did it, like, literally, like, it was a really unique time in music. And I didn't know any better, so I didn't know if that's how things were always done or if that's how things were mm-hmm. always going to be done. But now that I'm older, I realize that it was just a really small piece of time mm-hmm. that was just very unique. You know what I'm saying? And it was the bonding points for us. Like, we're all still great friends. And, you know, like, some of us speak more than others, but we always check for each other. We always reach mm-hmm. out for each other. And we always acknowledge the brotherhood that exists between us. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? I don't think any one of us could ever reach out to any one of us and say that we needed each other. and that the others wouldn't try to be there for you. You know what I'm saying? Like, mm-hmm. we represent something that's so dope. And I wish we would revisit it on occasion. If all of us would just take time from our busy schedules mm-hmm. for maybe 1 week, 2 weeks, that we all just got together and stayed together and hung mm-hmm. out and made music. You know what I'm saying? Let alone did a tour or put out a fucking album or some shit. That would be amazing. Yeah. And, you know, and it would be something that I honestly think the world needs to see, because in my opinion, we didn't do something that we asked the world to do. We didn't stay together. We didn't build off of the roots that we planted. Mm. We asked the people to be something that we couldn't be a microcosm of. You know what I'm saying? So today, you know, like, you talk of the native tongue, it's not a unity. You can't make a check to the native tongue. There's no tour, there's no promotional company, there's no marketing company, there's no label that exists. We didn't kind of do some of the things that we needed, that we asked you to do. You know, like, we asked you, everybody, you know, to empower yourselves, to incorporate yourselves, to move, you know, judiciously and intelligently in this present day. And, you know, and it makes sense out of everything. And once we kind of got to the point where us as individuals were all right, we were okay with that. Mm-hmm. And I don't mean to say that in a bad space. I mean to say that it is never too late for us to be who we're supposed to be. You know what I'm saying? I wish we could come together even now and be what we were asking the people to be. Like, mm-hmm. you know, and show them, like, you know, when we put our money together, we're able to become something bigger. When we put our energy together, we become something greater. We can, you know, put a tour together, and all of us could still do everything that we normally do without, you know, without each other. But we become so much greater mm-hmm. when we put it together on a world platform. You know what I'm saying? And this is my word. Whatever we all make as individuals, if we came together, we'd probably make more. Mm-hmm. You know, but sometimes we get caught up in, I'm okay, so I'm not going to do anything that makes me not okay. Mm-hmm. You know, and you got to respect that too. Mm-hmm. You know?
But you try to, like, carry on the legacy and build on the roots and like the legacy of native tongues when you collab on evitaN as a duo.
Oh man, that was such a me and Jarobi doing that project was such an amazing thing, because I had been reaching out to Jarobi for probably about a year and a half prior. Like, yo, you know, I have my own independent mm-hmm. label called A Pool of Genius. Check me out at poolofgenius.com. So I've been trying to get Jarobi to get in the studio, because I'm like, yo, you've been on stage with A Tropical Quest for 20 years. You have to be dope. You have mm-hmm. to be. There's no way around it. So for a year, he was like, nah, I'm doing this. He's a chef. He's like, nah, I'm busy. I'm doing this. And he was in Atlanta. So he moved to New York out by chance. And I had just happened to reach out, and he was like, yeah, okay. Wow. Okay, cool. We jump in the studio. And it was just for Jarobi to record. And so I figured the easiest thing to do would be to record a song with him to kind of ease him into mm-hmm. recording his own music. So the first song we ever did is a joint called Keep Keeping On. There's actually a video for it on YouTube. Check out Keep Keeping On by evitaN.
We just be blessed, ridiculous. Me, I'm Dr. ES, I spit for love. Hi, I'm Jarobi Continental, spilling words on your thoughts, leaving stains on your mental. Let your light shine throughout your lifetime. Keep keeping on. Keep inside, keep my time.
That's the first song we ever recorded. And that shit is amazing. It's an amazing piece of work. And so we play it for all our friends, Tip included. Tip is like, yo, y'all ought to be a group. And Jarobi tells me, I'm like, wow. I'm like, where? I was like, let's just record another song. So we just record another song. We wound up recording about 25, 26 songs. Wow. Next thing I know, I'm like, yo, wow, like, this is special. And we just started, you know, reaching out to different friends that did video and started putting videos together. Like, there's probably about 5 or 6 videos for the project. If you don't own the evitaN project, you definitely need to check for it. evitaN, name of the project's called Speed of Life. And evitaN is native spelled backward. Mm. It's definitely a dope project that you might have never heard of.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And also, I think one of the most interesting things about you as a solo artist is that there are some, like, there's a whole, like, great group of people and hip-hop listeners, and not only that, are familiar with your voice but might have never heard in the Black Sheep albums, like, you know, from the engine number 9, right.
engine number 9 on the New York Transit line. If my train goes off the track, pick it up, pick it up, pick it up back. Come on. On the
from that, like, and Fatman Scoop remix, I believe, right?
Very true.
So how do you feel about that?
I'm one of the most blessed people in hip hop, you know, like, I'll be standing next to someone, you know, and they don't know who I am until I go on stage, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, like, I've had an opportunity to have a hit record and everyone know who I am and all of the things that come with that, all of the attention, and it's a bit nerve-wracking. It's a bit much, it's a little bit too much for me personally. So as time has gone by for me, and, you know, Black Sheep is kind of not so much to hip-hop heads, but just as far as the limelight, kind of fell to the background more so. It's been kind of cool for me because I still have the privilege of traveling the world, of doing all of this music, and, you know, but not necessarily being in the forefront of everyone's television or app or, you know, reality, anything. You know, like, I know what it's like to be, not be able to scratch your ass without being on someone's, you know, picture. You know, so it's cool for me. I get a chance to kind of just live in my neighborhood. No one even cares, you know what I'm saying, about my comings and goings. And at the same time, you know, I'm about to go rock tonight with the elite of hip hop, you know what I'm saying? So I'm a very, very happy dude, you know what I'm saying? I have a beautiful family. I don't feel like I've ever had a job. I've been doing what I do for over 25 years and I love it. So, you know, like, it's a privilege for me to just kick it with you here. And, you know, so I'm a real fortunate dude that when I started, I had no idea that this could be what I did for the rest of my life. It didn't exist. You know what I'm saying? Like, that didn't exist. So the fact that this is what I've been doing, man, I won. I won a long time ago, you know, sincerely.
All right. And just going back really quick to the memories of Native Tongues in those days, what are some of your favorite memories of Phife Dawg?
Phife. Phife was quite a character. He was funny, he was witty, very outspoken. And one of the dopest things about Phife that I didn't see as much when we were young as I saw later in life is that he had a moral compass. He was one of the cats that didn't do something because it was wrong, as opposed to getting caught. You know what I'm saying? And in particular, one thing that really, you know, I remember vividly was one night we were all hanging out at this club called Powerhouse. And Powerhouse was like the it spot probably of 1990. You know what I'm saying? Like, we're all hanging out. I think it was on 26th Street and like around 5th or 6th Avenue. Anyway, after the club is over, it's probably about 2, 3, maybe even 4 in the morning. And, you know, we're all youngsters, you know what I'm saying? Varying in age probably from 18 to 21, 22. And so, you know, a few of us probably have a couple of dollars in our pockets, but the group of us are getting on the train, you know what I'm saying, at this late hour in the morning, you know what I'm saying, to go home, be it Queens or Uptown, or, you know, even Brooklyn. But we were all getting on together regardless of what direction. And it's 4 in the morning, so we're all jumping the train. We're all hopping over the turnstile, all of us, except for Phife. Phife doesn't hop over, and I turn around and I'm like, yo, come on, like, you know, like, no one's here, like, you know, come on, like, you could, yeah, no one's gonna see you, come on. And he was just still hesitant, and for a second I was like, he can't be afraid, he just saw all of us do it. But it was only years later that I realized, like, Phife didn't do it because it was wrong. Like, you know, like, he just felt like, you know, like, not that it wasn't about getting caught or not getting caught, it just was the wrong thing to do, you know what I'm saying? And not to say that he didn't jump a turnstile, or that he did jump a turnstile, just that it gave him pause where it gave none of us pause. It was something that was real slight and real minuscule, jumping a turnstile at 4 o'clock in the morning. And it was only years later that I was able to remember that and be like, wow, like, you know, like, even as a kid, you know, like, he had a moral compass and he displayed that as a hip hop artist. Phife had a moral compass. He wasn't into sucker shit. He wasn't into to backhanded. He wasn't into, he was very deliberate, very, very much a person that worked very hard for everything that he had attained in hip hop. Therefore, he wasn't giving out passes. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And he didn't want you to give him nothing. He earned everything he got, and he wasn't gonna give you a pass either. You know what I'm saying? And you had to respect it. He was a good dude.
All right.
God bless him.
Rest in peace, Phife. One boy.
Peace, Phife. Peace.
Hey, yo, God bless your life.
Peace.
Peace.
Peace, Phife.
Peace.
Hey, yo, God bless your life.
Peace.
All right, so maybe if you could tell us quickly about your plans for the new album, which is coming like the beginning of next year, right?
Yeah. I'm working on... What I decided to do was to take a few of the things from this Tortured Soul project, a few of the things I have very much on purpose just made short versions of, because I'd like to release the full versions of them if they resonate with the people, as well as introduce some new music to them as well that I've been working on. I'm also working with me and Jarobi this year. We'll be doing a new evitaN EP. Mm-hmm. And on my Pool of Genius imprint, I'm going to be introducing the world to someone that is just so dope. His name is Alexander Simone. He's the grandson of Nina Simone. Mm. He is an amazing, amazing composer, writer, singer. We've already finished his first single and video. It's called Let Go. And this kid is so special, like his voice, he's a singer, but he plays keys as well. Literally, that he's the heritage of Nina Simone is so apparent in his music. And me and my people at Pool of Genius, we're blessed to be bringing you his first single and video. And, he's going to walk with us for a little while. So we'll be introducing some new music of Alexander Simone. Definitely check us out at the website and, find out a little bit more about him. Definitely stay up for this new evitaN project. And definitely just... give me a minute and you have some even more new Black Sheep Dress.
Well, all right, so maybe a couple last words for the fans in Poland?
I just want to say much love. I wish I got out there more often, you know what I'm saying, so I could come hang out with you dudes. But hopefully everybody checks for this new project called Tortured Soul. Hopefully everybody stays in touch with me, poolofgenius.com, if you're on IG or what have you, Black Sheep Dress. And on the real, let's make it happen, man. Like, I'm trying to come out and hang out with y'all on y'all stoops. You know what I'm saying? Love is love, big salute, and thanks for the years and years of love and support. Sincerely.
Right, thanks so much.
No doubt.
It was an honor.
Oh, it was a pleasure, no doubt. Same here. Before y'all guys jet, I can literally run to my crib real quick and grab y'all some t-shirts.
All right.
Okay. Cool. Cool, man. Nice.
Yeah.
Like, appreciate it.
So you posted a picture on Instagram, you had so much cool merch, and I was like,
yeah.
You have very dope merch.
Whoever fits what.
Wow, so
love
so
this
cool,
one.
Man.
Yeah,
wow.
Hey. The red one.
I bought it like on eBay or
somewhere, from a very
like
first
collectibles.
Tour. Yeah. We was running around with Ice Cube took us on his tour.
Really?
Word up. I was all with Ice Cube.
Wow.
Word up. I was so dope.
That's also a good thing in this tour merch. Then you can go back and like check the dates, check the cities.
Yeah, yes, exactly. Exactly. Oh, that's what I want to do. Like, wow, you know.
And
party tonight, I can't play. My shorty will be up in the morning, I can't stay. The party's rocking lovely indeed. Yo, DJ, turn it up, you know it's nothing but love on replay. I'm only-